knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
So far in this series, we've been looking at differential equations where there is one independent variable, such as time or position. These are all ordinary differential equations, or ODEs for short. But many phenomena in the natural world are too complicated to be described in terms of rates of change with respect to just one variable. For example, when ocean waves roll up onto a beach, you could describe the height of the water with a function, and that water height varies not only with distance from the beach, but also time as well, as waves form and move forwards. To describe situations like this, we need to consider our dependent variable, the water height, as a multivariable function, and the differential equation describing it will use the function's partial derivatives, making it a partial differential equation, or PDE for short. Just as we did for ODEs, we'll start with some terminology on types of PDEs that we will encounter in the upcoming tutorials. Most of it should feel very familiar from ODEs. Firstly, a PDE will always have a dependent variable, which we will often now denote with the letter U, and multiple independent variables. Next, the order of a PDE is the highest derivative of U that appears in the equation, and the degree of a PDE is the exponent on that highest derivative. A PDE is linear if there are no functions or products of the dependent variable. Otherwise, it is nonlinear. This means that any PDE with a degree higher than 1 is necessarily nonlinear. There are also two other terms we should know describing types of nonlinear PDEs. A PDE is semi-linear if only its highest order derivatives are linear, while the others may be nonlinear. A PDE is quasi-linear if only its highest order derivatives are multiplied by lower order derivative terms. The general forms of linear, semilinear, and quasi-linear first-order PDEs are shown here, with the Venn diagram showing the hierarchy. Let's take a look at some more examples. Here we have a PDE known as Berger's equation, and it's used to model diffusion of particles in a flowing fluid. We can see that it is a second-order PDE because of the second derivative term on the right, and it's also nonlinear because the middle term has a product of the dependent variable u with its derivative. But more specifically, it is semilinear because the second derivative term is on its own, while the first derivative contains the nonlinearity. Next, here is another PDE known as the Chaplygin equation, where the dependent variable is the capital letter phi, used to model aerodynamic flows near the speed of sound. This equation is linear, second order, and has variable coefficients. And here is the Schrödinger equation, famous for its use at the core of quantum mechanics, where the dependent variable is the complex-valued wave function, denoted by the capital letter psi. Like the last example, it is linear, second order, with variable coefficients due to the function v of x, t. If we expand the brackets on the right side, we would get a term with the second partial derivative of psi with respect to x, plus the function v of x, t times psi, where the lone partial derivative notation means that it is acting as an operator. For short, differential operators can be written using a capital D and a subscript to indicate which variables they are differentiating with respect to. So here, the term on the left would be D sub T, and the middle term has D sub X X. This is called the D operator notation, and it may seem a bit pointless for this example, but it can sometimes help in factorizing large partial differential equations into products of simpler differential operators, so it will help to get familiar with some of its properties that are a little less obvious. D squared means apply the D operator twice to whatever's in front. So for dx squared, it means dx of dx, which is the second derivative with respect to x. Operators in parentheses, like dx plus 1, means distribute the brackets and apply each operator to whatever's in front. So dx plus 1 of u means partial u partial x plus u. Since integration is like the inverse operator to differentiation, we can write integrals using a similar notation, that being d to the negative 1 power, often written as the fraction 1 over d. Basically, D operator notation is a way of writing the act of taking a derivative like a variable by itself, and this D variable obeys all the rules of algebra that we're familiar with, but it's a neat notational trick, because we can actually write the solution of a differential equation directly using D operators. For example, consider the expression 1 over d squared plus 4d plus 3, acting on a function f of x. If we set this whole thing to some variable y, then multiply both sides by the denominator and expand, exploiting the linearity of the d operator, we see that this really represents the solution to the ordinary second-order differential equation, y double prime plus 4y prime plus 3y equals f of x. We can evaluate these inverse D operator expressions, which effectively amounts to solving the differential equations they represent, and there are some useful formulae for doing so for some common functions f of x. For example, if f of x is an exponential function e to the kx, then any differential operator, denoted capital F of d, acting on e to the kx, is equal to f evaluated at k times e to the kx, as long as f of k is non-singular. For example, if we take the ODE we just saw and apply the differential operator represented by it to the function e to the 5x, and apply the formula on the left, we get 1 over 48 e to the 5x, which represents the particular integral to the differential equation y double prime plus 4y prime plus 3y equals e to the 5x. This is essentially the method of undetermined coefficients for finding particular integrals to non-homogeneous ODEs we learned earlier. That's enough on D operator notation for now. Let's get back to PDEs. A major class of PDEs we will be studying are the linear second-order PDEs with constant coefficients, which can be generally represented as this sum of six terms, with all the different partial derivatives up to second order on the left multiplied by constants A through F, and a general non-homogeneous component, G of xy, on the right. Here it is in D operator notation. The way it is written here may bring to mind the equation of a conic section in 2D geometry, and indeed this class of PDEs has some analogous terminology that we need to know. The discriminant of a PDE is defined as the value of b squared minus 4ac, the same form as for a quadratic equation or conic section. If the discriminant is negative, we say the PDE is of the elliptic type. If the discriminant is zero, it is the parabolic type. And if the discriminant is positive, it is the hyperbolic type. Each type of PDE has solutions that behave differently. For example, hyperbolic PDEs tend to have solutions with traveling waves, while elliptic PDEs have either stationary waves or no waves at all. We will see the deeper connection on why they are named after the conic sections in a later tutorial. Lastly, let's discuss boundary conditions of PDEs. With second-order PDEs, in order to get a fully specified particular solution, we need two different boundary conditions, similar to the case in ODEs. There are three main types of boundary conditions that we can encounter in PDEs. The first is the Dirichlet type, which is where we specify the function u at a given value of one of the variables, like an initial condition from ODEs. The second is the Neumann type, which is where we specify any one of the derivatives of u at some set of points, similar to how we might have y prime of 0 equals 0 for an ODE. The third is the Robin type, which is sort of like a combination of the other two, where we specify an ordinary differential equation that the solution u must satisfy on a certain set of points, typically chosen to be the boundary of the domain of our solution u. If a PDE is supplied with boundary conditions, the combined problem is referred to as a Cauchy problem. For a Cauchy problem to have a single particular solution, it needs to be what is referred to as well-posed, which requires the solution to satisfy the three properties of existence, meaning at least one solution exists, uniqueness, meaning only one solution exists, and smoothness, meaning that a small change in the initial conditions produces a small change in the solution. Unlike with ODEs, it is trickier to rigorously identify the number of boundary conditions required to make a given Cauchy problem well posed. It is not necessarily equal to the order of the PDE. So when modeling situations with PDEs, care must be taken to ensure that the physical solution is not under-constrained or over-constrained. Let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.